All right. Looks like it's not quite 11, but. All right. Oh, by the way, since they announced, you know, ask before taking pictures yesterday, feel free to for this one, and feel free to live tweet it. If you like the presentation, my Twitter handle is TheSweetCat, and if I sucked, my handle is Dr. Bearsack. Don't tell him. All right, it's 11. First of all, thank you all for getting up so early. If you're like me, you're running on just a few hours of sleep, but still made the 3-2-1 rule. So the TLDR behind wanting to give this talk is that I really think InfoSec benefits from a wide variety of perspectives presenting at our conferences and a diverse slate of voices. But when it comes to CFPs, I see way too many people shiver with anticipation. So a lot like Dr. Frankenfurter, I'm going to attempt to remove the cause and hopefully the symptom. And if you haven't seen Rocky Horror Picture Show, I promise the entire talk isn't full of references because I didn't want to go over the heads of people who might not have seen it. So why I'm up here, a lot of this, the idea behind this talk came from me literally reading hundreds of CFPs. CFP, by the way, is call for presenters, call for proposals, call for papers, all sort of the same thing, the thing you do to apply to speak at a con. I've been a CFP reviewer for CircleCityCon for the past 3 years, and I was a co-chair for the first time this year, so I've seen a lot of patterns and a lot of people debating whether or not to apply and getting in their own way. Last year, I was also a mentor for B-Sides Las Vegas' Proving Ground, and I actually went through that as a speaker as well in 2013, so I've been on both sides of the sort of mentoring a talk process. It's sort of different from public speaking, but I grew up doing a lot of music and theater, and so it's still being on stage, just, you know, performing somebody else's words instead of your own, and I write some stuff. And another big piece of the driving force behind this talk is that, like a lot of people with InfoSec, I have anxiety, and a lot of it, regardless of what it's about, whether it's speaking in public or even thinking about speaking in public, it comes down to fear of the unknown. When we're lacking in information, our brains will jump to the worst possible conclusions. But eventually, you just have to not let it paralyze you when you have something to say, because a lot of us do have valuable things to contribute. A while back, I tweeted out for people who had never submitted to a conference before, I asked what was stopping them. And a lot of the common themes were just self-doubt, imposter syndrome, fear, uncertainty, and self-doubt. Many doubted their own ability to speak publicly or contribute anything meaningful. I've never given a talk before. I'm afraid of being rejected. I'm afraid of being accepted. I don't know what to talk about. I don't have enough name recognition. I'm not a famous InfoSec rock star. A lot of these things. And so a lot of it came down to lack of familiarity with the CFP process. It seemed overwhelming for people who had never been through it before. And so I wanted to demystify the process as much as possible and just make it more familiar and hopefully encourage people to speak. There are a lot of other resources out there for writing and CFP submissions and presentation slides, and I'll address a few of those. There weren't as many that dealt with the mental blocks of even getting to the point of submitting a talk. So I want to take you through the entire CFP life cycle and address the what-ifs along the way and break down this very large, overwhelming task of creating a conference talk and break it into small, more palatable and approachable steps and just, like I said, reduce the fear of the unknown, address every step of the way what's the worst that could happen, because in reality it's not nearly as scary as a lot of people think it is. As far as questions, if people are awake enough to want to participate, because audience participation, Rocky Horror, yay. I'll take questions at the end of each section if you want, instead of just throughout the talk. I'll also take some at the end. If you have a long life story, for the sake of being fair to other people who might want to ask things, just find me afterward instead of asking it here. But yeah, at the end of each section, feel free. I want to answer as many things as possible. Step one, developing a talk. What if I don't know what to talk about? This first step stumps a lot of people. Above all, think of something that you could talk about for hours. Between researching, rehearsing, giving the talk, and answering any follow-up questions for months afterward, which does happen, you are going to spend hours talking about whatever you talk about. Pick something that you're truly interested in, not just something that's going to get you a free conference ticket. Apathy is really easy to spot, and it doesn't make for good quality talks, and it's not fair to the staff and the attendees. Some conferences can get you started with this. They might post suggested topic areas or a wish list, especially topical things in a given year. A lot of conferences have themed tracks, like a really common one is like an offense track and a defensive track. And if you get stuck, you can always brainstorm with a friend. There's really no need to keep your talk ideas a secret. I mean, maybe a little bit if you're doing some kind of like really cutting edge research, but even then, it doesn't hurt to get input, and that's going to be a common theme of this. Ask your friends what you don't shut up about. That's why I'm here right now, from the experience of having read a bunch of talks and seeing the same things over and over. And what if your topic's been done already? And this is probably going to happen because, like they say, there are only 10 stories in the world. And so things that have been talked about before have, I just I blew the end of my own sentence. I got not enough sleep last night. but a lot of things have been touched on before, and that's okay. That means that you're thinking about the important things that a lot of other people are thinking about. So don't automatically exclude yourself from the conversation just because someone somewhere might have also talked about social engineering. I think there might even be, you know, a village or 100 about that. That said, never ever plagiarize. Your words need to be your own. But you have the benefit of being able to look at past conference schedules and past talk archives on YouTube or other places and just do like a lit review like they do for academic papers. See what's being said, look at blog posts with similar subject matter, and then see what's not being said. Use that to see how your material fills in the gaps. And this will help really inform your research and hone your focus regardless of how much attention your topic has gotten. If your topic has been discussed at length, you really need to focus on the ways that your talk builds off of that existing body of research and adds a fresh perspective. But you can always use other people's material to reference. You just need to give credit where credit is due. But, I mean, science isn't always, you know, a new discovery that no one has ever thought about before. It's building off of other people's work. So how you decide to submit your talk at a certain con, because there are so many InfoSec cons out there. Again, schedule archives and YouTube videos might give you a good sense of what the con is about. Some cons are more transparent with what they want than others. I mean, like O'Reilly Security is a purely defensive con. DEF CON is a hacker con. So like, your talk on building a SOC might not fit in at DEF CON, but it might be a really good fit for some place like Sector, which has an entire management track. So just look at what they might be looking for and tailor it accordingly. Think about the audience you're trying to reach. You want to, it's like when you're writing a resume, you tailor the resume to the specific position. You don't necessarily have one because it's going to change based on your audience. For writing the talk proposal, the cardinal rule is follow the directions of the given con CFP. I get asked, what do I write? And first thing, it depends on the con. The thing that I see a lot of is lack of detail in the abstract and the outline and everything, and reviewers aren't mind readers, so you really need to show how you plan to present your content. break it out into sections and really put in more detail than you think you need, because you need to make your talk stand out. As I said, the same topics get brought up a lot, and we need to see how it's different. And that'll help you in the long run. Shameless plug, I wrote a blog post on CFP writing last fall. Another good resource for that is DEF CON's Speaker Corner blog. Nikita wrote, who runs the DEF CON CFP, wrote a good example of a detailed outline. That's where I see most people getting in their own way. If writing isn't your strong suit, don't be afraid to ask for help copy editing or getting feedback on the content, especially if it's from somebody who's not an InfoSec or is new to your particular field of InfoSec, because you're ideally trying to reach an audience who might not be familiar with your topic, so you want to make sure that what you're saying makes sense. So it never hurts to do that. And copy editing, you're not necessarily going to get eliminated automatically for typos, but you want to show that you can, that you have attention to detail and that you're not going to be sloppy with your presentation, because a sloppy outline can be an indicator of that. So, again, tailor it for the specific audience, and really, if you've got some sort of specialization, you need to, actually spell out what you're trying to say. Especially if it's not an InfoSec con where you're delivering an InfoSec talk, you might have to go a little further in terms of breaking down the terminology that you're using. Like, you might just breeze through a talk where you mentioned Kali at an InfoSec con, and if you're at, like, a developer conference, you might have to say, you know, Kali is an operating system for pen testing. So. Before we get to the next one, are there any questions about developing talk? All right, great. So what happens once you actually hit submit and send your talk? So let's go behind the scenes to what happens after you apply. Different cons have completely different CFP review processes depending on their approach and their mission. It's always perfectly fair to ask what a con's process entails. The worst they can say is we don't discuss it publicly, which is their prerogative, but most places are fine to talk about it. Some cons have a talk selection by public voting, but the vast majority have a review board of some kind, and honestly, for an audience of hackers, public voting seems like a recipe for disaster. Even small cons will have a review board. Decisions about a submission are rarely made by one person alone, and so that'll save you from, that one person who might have really, really hated your talk. You know, there are checks and balances. Your talk will be scored or rated according to several possible criteria. These might include things like the amount of detail in your abstract and outline, whether you've given the same talk previously at other cons, because especially with new research, they might want to see that they're the first place where you've given it. How well your topic aligns with the format or the theme of the conference. Again, like an offensive talk at a defense con might have a little more trouble. And above, also just whether or not you followed their instructions. Some cons also will opt for a blind review process where the reviewers don't see the speaker names, or at least a blind initial round and then a non-blind final approval, while others will include speaker information as part of the decision-making process. Maybe they want an expert in one thing, and they're going to look for that. That's another reason it's key to never include identifying information in your outline or your abstract, just in case it's a blind review. You don't want to upset that that guard against bias. And on the note of a blind versus non-blind, a lot of people wonder how much their reputation matters. There's a lot of hype about InfoSec rock stardom, and a lot of people think that you have to be elite rock star or super smart and accomplished to even speak. And honestly, it depends on the nature of the CFP review system and, again, the mission of the conference, But usually, reputation really does not matter as much as people think. Even non-blind reviews may still look for specific content over specific people. If you've got someone who can give a good reverse engineering talk and they sound like they know what they're talking about, maybe it won't matter if they've got 2 years of experience versus 12. And being a rookie can be advantageous sometimes. Some conferences will favor new speakers. Like I know ShmooCon says, we really want to hear from first-timers. And some cons even have a rookie track, like B-Sides Las Vegas and B-Sides London both have a sort of proving ground track where they pair you with a seasoned presentation mentor to get you some help so that you can develop your talk that you've never given before. Above all, don't let the lack of speaking creds stop you from submitting. All of the speakers who are well-known now had to start somewhere. Remember that. They didn't just come into this being a rock star. They had to build that stage presence. And again, if you're unsure, look at past schedules. See how many big names you recognize. See if it's just a con of all the well-known people. And then apply anyway. You've got nothing to lose. Any questions about the waiting period? All right. Yep. Yeah, some places do. And again, there are places where you can look for an example of an outline, like DEF CON has one that they break out as an example. Shmoo does as well. I wrote a sample outline or a fake outline that's publicly available. And some cons will say specifically, like, we're looking for a short abstract of 200 words and a long abstract of 400 words, or we're looking for an abstract and an outline that looks like this. So it's very con dependent. All right, anyone else? Okay, so is everyone feeling pretty good right about now? Okay, let's talk about rejection. So it's just a fact of life, and people take it way too personally, to put it bluntly. These reasons are probably unlikely to be the actual reasons. There are many things that could have happened and factored into it. Don't assume the worst. There could be, like I said, not enough detail in the outline. Your topic could have been really common. We had to reject several, phishing and social engineering talks because there were a bunch on the same topic this year. It could be a really competitive applicant pool. I know Shmoo's acceptance rate is something like 15%. It could have also just been off topic for the conference, and sometimes they'll tell you that, and occasionally they'll reroute it. Like, I've submitted things to DEF CON that have gotten rejected and said you should submit it to one of our villages instead, where it's gotten accepted. So, yeah, it never hurts. But just, when I was doing a podcast, with Joe Gray back in December, he had a great quote. You either win or you learn. So, like an error message, a CFP rejection provides actionable information for improvement. So use that feedback from reviewers to rework your submission. Often they'll ask you to provide more detail or to narrow your focus because a lot of people go too broad, and that causes trouble in setting you apart from the crowd. Like if you just submit, I'm using social engineering a lot, but it's a really common topic right now. I want to talk about social engineering. Okay, that's a really wide field. What do you want to talk about within it? I want to talk about phishing. Okay, that's still a really wide field. Go deep rather than going wide. And so, yeah, use that feedback and just remember again, InfoSec cons aren't monolithic. Some build their schedule around specific types of talks, and they're trying to make a balanced schedule so that you don't have 10 talks about the same subject. So it could have been many, many factors out of your hands. So you can keep going and look for a con where it might be a good fit. Any questions about rejection? It's okay. It's my own fault for scheduling this so early. Cheryl. You mean after you've been rejected? The question was, what's a good approach to asking for feedback after you get rejected? Reach out to either the con organizers or the CFP chairs, and they can hopefully, route you in the appropriate direction. Above all, just be humble about it. Don't try not to be butthurt about why you're rejected. Again, remember that this is probably something out of your hands, or it's something in your hands that you can fix. And it's probably not an insult to who you are as a human. So hopefully they'll be gracious and give you constructive feedback instead of just feedback that, oh, this was a horrible talk. We want people to learn and do better. All right, anyone else? All right, so now is the scariest part of all. What happens when you get accepted? So what if you're not ready to give a talk? How do you prep? You can't prepare for everything, but you can take steps to mitigate the risk of something going horribly wrong. Rehearse, prepare backups, and breathe. Use all of the available resources that you have to rehearse and get feedback. And you have a lot more than you think. Local InfoSec and tech meetups are a good place to flesh out talks that you haven't given before at a con. Because a lot of them will have tech talks or workshops, or even if they don't, you could probably just test out your content stealthily. And also hackerspaces, you could like turn your talk into a workshop and leave it there or give a talk there. Even speak for your friend, in front of your friends. Or your cat, you know, if you don't have any friends. and especially, you'd be surprised how much friends can tell you, even if they haven't spoken themselves, or if they're not in InfoSec, they still can give you a lot of good advice about your stage presence, your delivery, and on the subject of saying, in the past, I've run talks with a friend of mine holding a Nerf gun and nerfing me every time I say the word, Still hasn't broken me of the habit, but it's gotten way better than it was 2 years ago. So that kind of thing. Use what you've got, and people are usually really happy to help. There I go again with the ums. Where are you, Grant? Also, Toastmasters is a really good organization for honing your public speaking skills, and that's entirely what they do, public speaking and leadership skills. There are chapters of Toastmasters in almost every major city. Some have more than one. And it doesn't even have to be public speaking things that help you get ready, get in the zone. Just find ways to practice being comfortable on stage or being comfortable in front of a crowd. Improv troupes and improv classes are a good way to do this. Theater, music performance, even karaoke. Just anything that you can do to get comfortable wielding the microphone and hearing your own voice, because it's really weird the first time. As far as prepping slides, I'm not going to spend too much time on that, because I'm admittedly not the best designer. But just as a very low bar baseline, don't do this. Especially not with the making things great again. Stop making things great again, please. So the talk itself, you can't prepare for everything, like I said, but you can do as much contingency planning as you can. Aim to have your talk rehearsed to the point where you can improvise. If your laptop catches fire mid-presentation, you might have to do this. Have backups of your slides and any demos. Make a little sacrifice to the demo gods, but then have a picture of it if it doesn't work, because it probably won't. Especially keep a PDF in case the slide formatting gets all messed up, because that's definitely a thing that happens. And don't just store it locally. You want to have backups upon backups. And this actually saved me a few years ago in SkyTalks. My video port just completely ate shit and died, so we had to swap out with my boyfriend's iPad, and I had to ad-lib for like 10 minutes on stage to a room full of, SkyTalks, to a room full of pretty drunk people in Vegas. But it worked. And even if something does go wrong, assuming you don't plagiarize or spout complete bullshit or drop a cyber every other word non-ironically, audiences are generally pretty forgiving. And they may not even notice what you perceive to be flaws in your presentation. We're all our own worst critics. I still cringe watching my talks. basically, just as you're doing a security, like, disaster prep plan, the more potential points of failure you prepare for, the less mental energy you have to exert when worrying about what's going to go wrong when you're actually in the thick of giving the talk. And even if the worst happens, you can probably recover. I've had everything from, like, video failure to literally having a panic attack on stage, and, like, leaving the room in tears. So that's an extreme example, but like I said, you probably did better than you think you did, and even if you didn't, it's okay, and you will probably go on unless you've done something so egregious that they throw you in the pool. Any questions about preparing to speak? All right. So we've kind of blown through this pretty quickly, but do feel free to ask things at the end as well. Just to sum up, whether you know it or not, you probably have an idea worth sharing. You have something that you're passionate about. That's why we're all here. And it's just a matter of finding that and building it into something that you can deliver and share with others. Find the right venue, find your voice, and share what you have to say with the world. You have nothing to lose. The worst that can happen isn't actually that bad. Or as a certain mad scientist put it, don't dream it, be it. Questions? All right, thanks.